cover the reading of the scripture coming from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. Praise the Lord, God is love. That's the title of these verses of scripture. And it reads this way. My beloved friends, let us continue to love each other, since love comes from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God. The person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God, because God is love. So you can't know him if you don't love. This is how God showed his love for us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. This is the kind of love we are talking about. Not that we once upon a time loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to clear away our sins and the damage they've done to our relationship with God. My dear, dear friends, if God loved like this, we certainly ought to love each other. No one has seen God ever. But if we love one another, God dwells deeply within us, and his love becomes complete in us. Perfect love. Praise the Lord. That's from the Message Bible, 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. Praise the Lord. The word of God is always, has always been blessed. Just join me for some prayer. We lift up the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, who is worthy of the praise. For at the behest of God, he came down through 42 generations, hung, he bled, and he died. While we were yet sinners, separated, wanting to kill him, he died for us. So today, in every day of our lives, we give him the glory, we give him the praise, and we give him the honor. So we thank you, Lord God, for the presence and the power of your Holy Spirit that rests, rules, and abides in us, those whom you have called and those whom believe. We thank you. And so, Lord, on this day, this morning, we pray, Lord, and ask that your Spirit guide us in one more opportunity to cast out, Lord, that lifeline to some or one who may not know you in the part of their sins. We ask that the power of the Holy Spirit fall fresh on the word, on the speaker and the deliverer of the word and the receiver of the word, that your will might be accomplished. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you that as ordinary people, Lord, you so desire to use ordinary people for your glorious ministry. We thank you, praise you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Hallelujah and amen. Praise the Lord.
Good morning to all who have chosen to worship with us on this Lord's Day. We greet you with Jesus' joy, a spiritual provision that is given to us by the Holy Spirit that operates regardless of what the situation in life is. I want to particularly address those who have not yet accepted God's wonderful offer through the person of his Son, Jesus the Christ. We are praying for you. Our sacred poet reads as follows. Sister Gertrude Jones, West Hampton Care Center. Sister Irene Marshall, West Hampton Care Center. Brother Bernard Langhorn Hampton Center for Rehabilitation and Nursing, Southampton. Sister Lucinda Ross, Southside Hospital, Bayshore. Reverend Winfred Pippin, Nassau County Hospital. At home, Sister Earlene Trent, Sister Anitra Graham, Brother Sean Reed, Brother William Antolini, Brother Tom Langhorn, Sister Earlene Brown, Sister Hazel Thomas, Sister Ida Wolf, Sister Joan Green, Sister Sharon No, Sister Patty Johnson, Brother Carnell Hobson Jr., Brother Chase Gore, Sister Barbara Harris, Sister Marie Trent, Brother Sam Johnson, Brother Andrew Langhorn, Sister Lena Hawkins, Sister Gloria Wright, Brother Louis Dacus, Brother Justice Davender. Please continue to pray, send cards, call, and visit the above. Remember the pastor's family in your prayers and let us continue to pray for one another. Anyone who has a name for the sick list, please feel free to call, text, or email Sister Annie Collins by Saturday morning. Also, please let us know if someone can be taken off the sick list. That ends the reading of the sick report.
Praise the Lord, friendship. Praise the Lord. I'm here on behalf of the best finance committee in the world, our finance committee. And I'm just here on behalf of the finance committee just to say, please continue to bring tithes and offerings into the storehouse. We thank you. We bless you for what you're doing. And we pray that soon, very soon, we can all gather in again and worship together here in the sanctuary. But in the meantime, we just need to be able to keep things rolling, keep the train rolling, and we bless you because as a result of the tithes and the offerings and the giving of our friendship, we have been able to keep things going. And so praise the Lord. The finance committee is here on Sunday mornings, I think up until around 12 o'clock. So continue to do what you're doing and be blessed. Praise the Lord.
Bye. all family and friends. I greet you with blessings and favor, thanking my sister Reba Moore. She chose the song, and I know it was the right one because she didn't know what I was going to say this morning. So I pray the blessing of God on her spirit as she grows into her ministry. This morning, I would like to come from the book of 1 John, chapter 3, verse 1, verse 14, verse 24, and 2b. 2b is very important. I'll be reading from the King James Version. So that you might write them down and you might read them later as I speak on Romans 5, 1 through 5, Romans 8, 1, Romans 12, 1 and 2, and another passage, very important, Ephesians 4 and 14. 6 things worth knowing. Worth knowing. The meaning of know. Not N-O, but K-N-O-W, as a verb. The dictionary says, having developed a relationship with someone through meeting and spending time with them. In 1 John, I like to think as a book of instruction on knowing, worth knowing. We know a lot of things. We have a lot of things in our mind. Some of them we need to let go. Are they worth knowing? I take up one chapter in John with the word know. As I said, 6 things worth knowing. The first verse of the 3rd chapter says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. In that, we know he was manifested. He came to take away our sins. We know that. That is something we know. Why? Because God said so. Some people say it makes no difference what a man believes. If he is sincere in his belief, but why would you even think it's not important? It makes all the difference in the world. What you know helps what you believe. We are spiritual beings, and the Spirit of God has bore witness to its truth, the truth of the Word of God. So the first thing we know is Jesus Christ came to take away our sins. The second thing, we believe, we know the truth. The Spirit of God is the witness that dwells inside of us to the truth. Verse 14, we know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brother. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. That's the third thing worth knowing. We understand at baptism and the purpose of baptism, the symbolism of baptism, as we go down and we come up into a new life, because to be in Christ, we are new creatures. We know that because we're believers and we believe God and His Word. If I was to ask you, and I could ask you, and you could answer me, I'd ask you, do you believe that? Not only believe it, do you know that in your heart? Christ came to call us from death to life. Do you think we have to go on in this unknowing? We have brothers and sisters who don't know that. So they live their lives according to someone else's opinion or what they think. God does not leave us with that uncertainty. But if you have malice and hate against someone, that is such a sign that you have not got the Spirit of Christ. You may know you have not been born of God. That might be a thought. For God is love. If you meet someone and you have a conversation, they'll tell you, oh girl, I know that. I knew that. You know, you ain't saying nothing, but do you know it? You have a thought in your mind. Who put that thought there? What you thinking? What is that? Does it have to do with life? And life in Christ and being born again. So the third thing, we know that we have passed from death to life. The fourth thing, God does not leave us with that uncertainty. The fifth thing worth knowing is in verse 24. And he that keepeth his commandment dwelleth in him, and he that keepeth his commandments, Christ dwelleth in him, and he in them. And hereby we know that we abide in us, the Spirit which he hath given us. In John 3:17, Jesus prayed for us. He prayed for his disciples then, and he also asked God for us, the next generation, as we pray for the next generation. That he's in God, God is in him, he's in us, so we're in him, in the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We must have that understanding, and we must believe. And on that we believe, we know, I know this. Ephesians 4 and 14, so we will not be children tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. By someone who lies to us, but makes the lie sound the truth. But we know, my sheep know my voice. We know. And that's above, oh girl, I know. That's, I'm solid. You can't get in my head. You can't change my mind. I know this right here. We know that he abides with us, the fifth thing, by the Spirit which he has given us. If we are out backbiting our neighbors and living like the world, it is good evidence that we have not been born of God. Now, I was given an argument on that because the young man told me, I've been baptized. I'm saved. I'm not saying we're not saved. You've been baptized and you're saved. You stood and said you believe Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose. But the acceptance, that's not the end. That's not all. There is more that we have to do so that we can be who we are. We can look like we're supposed to look. We can talk like we're supposed to talk. We can live under whatever comes when we surrender. And that's Romans 12 and 1, 8 and 1. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those that love the Lord. My pastor told me to connect the dots. So I pray, that's what I'm doing right now, that we have a clear understanding of the purpose of our belief, the gift of salvation, what Jesus did for us and justified. He did that. We didn't do it. We can't earn it. We can't work it up. It was a gift. A wonderful gift. And no matter what we do, we're still there. Because we serve a forgiving God. The sixth thing worth knowing is the best of all. It's part of verse 2, the last part. Behold, beloved, now we are the sons and daughters of God. Isn't that wonderful? When you know that, when you can stand on that. John wants us to understand the acceptance of God. In our disobedience of the unconditioned love. That's Romans 5, 1 through 5. That's the love that he gave us. Shedding God's love, the Holy Spirit. No one else could give it to us. Shed it abroad in our hearts. We believe it, so we know it. So, I sin. And I was a sinner. And I repented. And God said, you forgive me. You got to believe and know that God forgives you. Because if you don't and you waver, someone will come up and remind you of what you did. And I don't know why you keep going to that church. Because I remember you. But you simply said, I'm God's son, I'm God's daughter, and I am forgiven. Because I know that. So the confidence inside of you of knowing that you belong to God, you believe Jesus Christ, that confidence shows forth. Sometimes you don't have to say anything. It shows up just in your presence. How you say good morning. How you say thank you to the lady checking out your food, the cashier. Especially nowadays. Because they're taking a risk. When the man comes out, even though you're in your car, to put gas in your car, most stations now, you have to do it yourself. But some stations still have an attendant. When you pay, you say thank you. That shows what you believe and who you are, greater than what you say. Satan cannot get there and block that in your mind because the power of the Holy Spirit holds that you know. Because he helps you. He was sent to comfort you, to help you, to lead you, to heal you, to guide you. And that you have inside of you. So no matter what comes at you, you know who you are. And you know who's with you. There is a book I was reading, and I believe the more you read the Bible, the more you study the scriptures. Some of the scriptures I have quoted or I asked you to read, you know those. You really do. I do. But do you know those? I learned from a great teacher. There is so much in here we never get to, because we get satisfied. And that's why God has to shake it up, because we're too comfortable. This is good. But there is more God has for us in the spirit, which on the inside will come to the outside. When I read this, I got excited and hollered. My walls are very thin in my apartment. So my neighbor knocked on the wall and said, believe me, in her apartment, knocked on the wall and said, are you all right? And I heard her. So now you know how thin my walls are. And I said, I'm fine. The truth was, I told her, I had to go outside, I got some honey out of a rock. It was just that sweet. That it just stays with me. And as I give it away in ministry so I can help someone, on their wilderness journey, I find there's a lot of people in a place today. The word is today. The word is for today. The Old Testament is, we go there as a reference to what God can do. So we know this. See, that's the difference between saying, oh, I know that, and I know that. I can walk this out. The power of the Holy Spirit is unlimited. It's spontaneous. There is absolutely nothing that's going to take place that hasn't already been taken care of. See, that's what you got to know so we don't get palpitations. And I'm not saying I don't, because I do. I'll wake up at 1 o'clock in the morning and everything is shaking. But then I go to the Word, and the Word is my peace and my comfort, and I can go back to sleep. The fear of the unknown. We have nothing to fear. I know you say, well, that's easy to say, but when you know that the Lord is your shepherd, when you know that, when David could have stopped right there and said nothing else, because what does a shepherd do? Think about it. So the Lord is my shepherd. I follow him. I have nothing to worry about. Worry might be doubt. We don't doubt what we know. In the 8th chapter of John, they're going to tell him that they doubt his word. In the 10th chapter, he is going to have his sheep in spite of those who wonder. We need to understand that and know that no matter what someone says or comes to you, God will have you as his sheep. He doesn't want to see no one lost. But some act like they're trying to be lost. Some believers, unbelievers, those that call themselves righteous, those that are unrighteous according to our opinion. But God has already, it is done. That's how much you got to believe what you know and know what you believe. It's already taken care of. I don't know how long this virus is going to be. I think it's going to be like, might be like cancer, like AIDS, high blood pressure, diabetes, just stay here. We might have to wear masks a long time. But this one thing I know, we know, God is. And that's all. And because we believe Christ Jesus, we're going to be okay. Sometimes we're going to have to suffer a little bit. That's part of it. He ain't promised you no rose garden. And if he did, he's got thorn. The more we go through, the more we face, we grow. We grow in the spirit, and that strength on the inside strengthens us on the outside, that we may face whatever comes at us. I would hope to believe that you will read 1 John, the whole chapter, 1 through 24, and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. If you see me, you say, somebody, this is what I got. That's fine. That's absolutely fine. Because the Holy Spirit has something for everyone. And everyone has a gift. And your gift will make room for you. God chose you. We're one with separate gifts that are supposed to work together. My pinky is my pinky, and my thumb is my thumb, and the fingers, but they're on the hand. But each one does its, or does what it was created to do. So I pray that I said something that you will think about knowing, that you will have a clear understanding of knowing. And the next time you meet someone who's talking to you and tries to tell you something that doesn't go with what you know, you can tell that I know. And then there's no argument, there's nothing to argue about, because I believe God. And because of free will, you have the right to believe what you want. The relationship, the time you spend in the Word, the time you spend praying and believing, you know more. There's so much to know. We won't know it all till Jesus comes back. But we can know more because we have the Holy Spirit. So if you heard me this morning and you want to know more, and you never let or came to Christ, let him into your life, you have an opportunity. I can't take your hand, but I always recommend. I was in 1 John, but we have the book of John. And most new believers, they give them the book of John to read. I encourage you to read it. Stand up and confess to God that you believe that his son died and rose for you. He took upon himself your sins. It's just that simple. It's not hard. So that's what I have this morning. I pray you've been blessed. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
We want to thank Evangelist Sonia for the word that God gave to her for us on this morning. Let me just say this. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. Come on, say that with me in your own. I know it was the blood. Oh, I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. Be blessed, my brother. Be blessed, my sister. Be blessed wherever this life leads you. Let me encourage you. Let me speak life to you. You can depend.